So I've been on keto for about a year now, and I feel like I am relearning basics all over again. And I don't know if it's because I get lazy or because I forget what I've learned, because I got a really bad memory. First of all, I've just been in this thing about, like, I refuse to track macros, and I don't know why. I guess because it's like, you know, that's not sustainable for me, and a lot of other people don't track macros. And the problem is that sometimes when I have a stall, or when I gain weight, or when I think I'm doing everything right and the scale doesn't move, then I have to kind of reevaluate, like, what happened? Did I have too much of something? And when I look back and it's like, God, I barely ate, then it's like, well, are you even eating enough? Like, maybe you're not having enough calories. I don't know, I always go back and forth about the need to track or not track. And I know I see success when I do track. And then I've sustained my success this entire year for the most part without tracking. So I'm always torn. Let me know if you track, because I know a lot of people do and a lot of people don't, and everyone has mixed feelings about it. So leave me a comment. Let me know if you're tracking, if it's easy for you. I woke up this morning with a newfound motivation, and I realized, it's like, you know, I haven't recalculated my macros. See, every time you lose weight, and I think they say usually like every 10 pounds, you should recalculate your macros, because your calories, your fat, your protein, they all will be different numbers. And this is if you're tracking. If you're not tracking, then you don't care. You just keep doing what you're doing, right? So that's why I never really thought much about it. I calculated it in the beginning. I plugged it into Carb Manager. And then I think right before the 30-day challenge, I might have recalculated it again so I can get the correct macros so I can track. Well, this time I was like, you know what? I'm going to plug in my current weight and see what kind of macros comes up. There's so many different macro calculators out there, and you never know which ones are accurate, which one should you go by. I always go to the ruledme.com, and I always go to that website because that's the one I've heard people talk about the most, about being the most accurate, and that's the one that they use. And so I was like, okay, well, I'll be consistent and I'll use that one. Well, you have to answer these questions about, like, how much body fat percentage do you have on your body? How much do you exercise? And then it's like, you know, do you want to lose weight, maintain weight? Do you want to lose? Like, there's all these different questions that you don't know what to answer. So when I filled it out, I put in my current weight. My height is even a question, because sometimes I'm 5'2", sometimes I'm 5'3". For the most of my life, it's been kind of like a 5'2.5". But as I'm getting older, is it more leaning towards 5'2"? I don't even know how tall I am. And even with my scale not being so consistent, I don't even know how much I weigh. So I'm going with the last weight. So I put in, I was 5'2.5". I put in my most recent weight that I weighed in at, which was 195. And then I put in, because I just had a birthday, so I'm 46. And I put in that I'm 46 years old. And then, like, body fat percentages. And the thing is, like, I don't have one of those scales that tell you what your body fat percentage is. So they have these pictures where you're like, okay, if you are 20% body fat, this is what your body looks like. If you're 25, and I'm like, oh my God, what am I, 40% body fat? Because in my eyes, which I'm not sure if it's accurate or not, but I don't see myself as any of those, right? So, and of course, when you lose weight, you still see yourself as before you lost weight, right? You know, so when everyone's going, oh my God, you look so different, I could see a huge change. And I'm like, really? Because I see a change a little bit, but not like, whoa, I look so different. You know, look how skinny I look. Like, it's that dysmorphia, right? The body image and look dysmorphia. So I kind of pick, like, I don't know, a 40% body fat, because I didn't think I looked like the 35 to 39 body fat. I don't know. It was like a guessing game. So I plugged in a number, and then somebody had told me to always put 1.0% as far as how active you are. But when I looked at what that says, it means, like, if you're working out every day, and if I'm not, I mean, I need to, I should, but in all actuality, I'm not. And especially with this quarantine, it makes it really easy to just stay home and not really push yourself. So at this point today, you know, it's sedentary. Like I don't, so I think I kept it at the 0.6% at the bottom. So it recalculated my macros for me. And right now it has me eating 1,324 calories, 107 grams of fat, and 70 grams of protein. So your fat is always supposed to be a little bit more elevated than your protein, which is hard because sometimes if you have two chicken thighs, that's your entire day's worth of protein. So if I ever want to be super, super strict, and you know, you've seen it, sometimes I do, sometimes I wanna be super strict and write every single thing down and keep track of everything. And I think it's good for me to have, and I probably should be doing that. So if I wanna do that, I have all of my macros in there. The only thing about me and tracking is if I know I have 1300 calories a day, in my head, I wanna eat 1300 calories a day. I have that bank that I could spend from, essentially. And sometimes I end up eating when I'm not hungry. And it's the same thing with intermittent fasting. It's like sometimes I'm either not hungry at 10 a.m., but I really want my coffee. So I break my fast for my coffee, but then my 8-hour window starts and I've gotta eat the rest of my food by 6 o'clock if I'm gonna do the next 16-hour fast. So that's the tricky part, because sometimes I've eaten a big, heavy breakfast or lunch, and then come dinner, I'm not that hungry. Then my window closes, the next thing you know, after my window, all of a sudden I'm hungry. And so it throws me off. So what I've realized is if I drink my coffee in the morning and maybe have a little light snack, unless I'm ravenous, if I'm starving, then I'll eat something. But if not, I can kind of graze or pick until I have my dinner. And I know that's not great either, because they say the less meals you have, the better, as far as your blood sugar and your glucose in your body goes. But for me, like, I don't snack and graze all day long. I don't have like a bowl of nuts by my computer, and you know, I don't do that. It's like instead of a meal, maybe I'll have a snack and then that's it. But what I realize, and I don't know if this is something that you're doing and you may realize as well, but if I'm drinking a ton of water, I'm not that hungry. And with my coffee, with my collagen, if I'm drinking my apple cider vinegar, if I want to take at least three of those big Yeti cups of water a day, like, who has time to eat? Like, I am totally full just by all of the drinking that I'm doing throughout the day. And so I find myself like only really needing the dinner. So I'm a big proponent of baby steps. Okay, this week I'm going to do the intermittent fasting. Let me just do the 16-8. If I can do the 16-8 and get my body used to eating within that 8-hour time period, then I'll be able to incorporate other things. So this week was my 16-8, and now I'm kind of gearing myself up to like maybe start tracking again. I've already eliminated the processed things, so I've got a whole basket full of Quest chips that I'm not touching, Quest bars, Caesar. We have a Bang left in the fridge. And you know, it's like as if you had like a piece of chocolate cake staring you in the face and you're like, okay, you gonna eat that? You gonna eat that? He's like, yeah, I'm gonna eat it. I'm gonna eat it today. You know, but he never eats it and you keep staring at it. And you're like, if you don't freaking eat that cake, I'm gonna eat it. That's kind of how it feels like with that Bang. Cause it's like, are you gonna drink that Bang? Oh yeah, I'll drink it tomorrow. Tomorrow came and went. I'm like, hey, don't forget that Bang is in the fridge because I gave up Bangs. I don't want, you know, to see one because I want to drink it. So he was supposed to take it today. He didn't take it today. So now I'm going, there's a Bang in the fridge that I know about. Ugh. So anyway, that's a baby step as well. Giving up the Bangs that I became addicted to on my vacation, giving up the Quest bars and all that processed stuff. And I'm really, really trying to limit making breads, goodies. I don't know why. I think my body reacts differently to almond flour. I could test it out next week, because this week I'm staying on plan. I'm gonna weigh myself, I think tomorrow, do a weigh-in and see how much I've lost while being, you know, on this 16-8 back to basics keto plan that I've been on. I mean, we're probably toughest and meanest on ourselves. And that's something, you know, with expectations. I expect me to be stronger. I expect me to lose 10 pounds a month. I expect, and that expectation is gonna be the death of me. Like, I need to not have so much high high expectations on myself to give myself a break and to pat myself on the back and be like, look what you did, look what you did, look what you did. This was you before, this is you now. Those were your old habits, these are your new habits. Congratulate yourself, right? And don't beat yourself up. Like I always say, I'm a work in progress. We are all a work in progress. And sometimes it takes us a little bit longer than others to kind of realize some of these things. All right, it's time for the apple cider vinegar drink. So I'm gonna go ahead and start off with some ice, pour some water in there. I'm gonna do a little sprinkle of the ginger, the cinnamon. I broke my lemon squeezer, so I'm gonna have to figure out how to get all the lemon juice out of there. I broke it yesterday, so I think it was because it wasn't fully ready to go and I might have squeezed it too hard. And then we're gonna put 2 tablespoons of apple cider vinegar. Getting a little hungry, but let me tell you why that's a problem. Because I put it in my carb manager and I went ahead and took out the meat, the steaks that we're gonna cook tonight, weighed them out on the scale to figure out how much each one is gonna weigh. So I already know before I eat anything today how much to expect for my calories for dinner, right? So just right now I put everything in and I already have 79 of my 70 grams of protein. So I'm already over on protein. So this is what's so frustrating about tracking, because the concept of eat when you're hungry, don't eat when you're not, all of that stuff, right? So it's like, I have to not eat pretty much the whole day if I'm going to stick to these macros, if I'm gonna stick to what I put in the tracking. Those of you who are new to what keto is, it is not a high protein diet. It is high fat, moderate protein, low carb. So you see, like, ignorance is bliss sometimes. Sometimes it's better to just not know that you're double on protein, but then when you have the question of why am I, you know, stalling, or why am I gaining weight, or why did I stay the same, or why did everybody else lose 35 pounds and I didn't, then you know. But this is the hard part about tracking, because I get like this. I get like in my head about numbers and about what's right, and it throws me off. The whole point of the tracking too is to see serving sizes, to see measurements. You know, when you're just pouring the heavy whipping cream in your coffee, you're not realize how many calories are going in until you get the measuring spoon and actually, you know, measure it out. So I see value in tracking. I see what it does to me, and I'm trying to find a happy balance. So let me know. I mean, are you tracking? Do you like tracking? Leave it in the comments, because I want to hear from you. I don't know if I'm the only one going crazy about all this. Maybe I'm the only one obsessing. It could be. All right, this is ridiculous. It's 2 o'clock. I am way too hungry to wait until dinner time. So I'm gonna go ahead and make myself something, add it into my macros, into my carb manager, and just see what happens. So I'm gonna go ahead and make this pouch of tuna, and I'm gonna do the tablespoon of this mayo that I used to make my ranch yesterday. I'm gonna have a couple of these slices of pickles and call it a lunch.
Oh. That hit the spot.
So hubby is making dinner tonight, and he is grilling some ribeye steaks. Oh my God, they look so good. And we are also having some sauteed zucchini and squash in the cast iron. All right, this is the masterpiece, the ribeye with the sauteed veggies. All right, here is my day fully tracked on carb manager. I inputted everything that I ate today. I had 1,248 calories out of 1,324. So I am just under in my calories, which is good, but I am over on protein. I have 95 grams out of 70. That's 25 grams of protein, and I'm sure it's because of the tuna. I am at 90 grams of 107 grams of fat. So that's good. I didn't go over on fat. They say as long as you stay under your fat, you should be okay. Use it as a lever to keep you full. I probably should have had something more fat heavy at lunch to keep me fuller, or maybe a bulletproof coffee in the morning would have kept me full throughout
the morning or afternoon. I did stay under on my carbs. I'm 4 net carbs out of 20, so that's good. Overall, I'm happy with my numbers for today. You don't have to close your rings. My biggest challenge was weighing everything out and inputting it into an app. That's not, you know, something that I'm used to doing every day, and I don't really like doing it, but this gives me an idea of what I ate, so not bad.